Hello, everyone. Anyone sitting in the front, please be mindful of the camera, of the recording. So, queer people of color at Virginia Tech, Newman Library, the Office of Multicultural Programs and Services, and the Women's Center welcomes you all to the inaugural Intersectional Identity Series event. I am Takara Watson. I'm a New Directions Couple and Family Therapist at Vera House in Syracuse, New York. So how Romi got here, I actually tweeted her around midnight, late night. I was basically a fangirl because I was surprised she actually tweeted me back. And at that point, Natasha was like, you should totally ask her to speak for Tupac. And then I did, and then things started happening. So thank you.
Thank you.
An awareness campaign founded by QPOC at VT, this identity series aims to give visibility to the nuanced personal and professional experiences of out and active queer people of color. Founded by Natasha Cox in 2012, QPOC at VT aims to give faculty, staff, students, and New River Valley community members the opportunity to understand and celebrate the diversity of being a person of color within the LGBTQ plus community. Through cultural arts, health, and advocacy programming, we acknowledge the challenges and triumphs, of racial and sexual minorities. We envision a campus and local community that is fully inclusive of sexual minorities of color and commit to dismantling racism, cystic sexism, heterosexism, and all other forms of oppression. QPOC at VT exec board recognition. Before we begin, we'd like to recognize them. For the board of QPOC, all of whom could not unfortunately be here tonight. However, if you are here, please stand and be recognized. marketing, Midori Oglesby.
No.
Nope. Community outreach chair, Monica Motley. Treasurer, Kendall Bullock.
Right there.
Vice president, Chris Tyler.
No.
And President Natasha Cox. So I'm going to introduce Romi. I'm going to say a quick thing and then she will be up here next. Romi Klinger comes to us from Long Beach, California, born in Los Angeles to a Mexican Native American father and a German mother and raised in Pasadena, California. She learned early in life to embrace the culture of abundance and the diversity around her. Exposing her life for the world to see, on Showtime's The Real L Word, Romi shared her struggles with alcohol, her commitment to getting sober, her love life, and her vision for her jewelry line. It's immense gratitude that Virginia Tech welcomes Romi Marie Klinger.
Thank you. Can you hear me? I don't know if this thing works. Is it good? I'm good? Here? Here, awesome. Thank you guys so much for having me. Yes, I did get tweeted in the middle of the night and asked to come speak here, and I was honored. And I do try and respond as much as I can on social media to anybody asking any questions about anything they've seen on television or about my story. So when they asked, I absolutely wanted to come. Thank you guys. It's a beautiful campus. I just got a tour by the most school-spirited man I've ever met. So pretty much if any of you don't know the show that I was on. I was on The Real L Word, which is on Showtime. Are you guys familiar with the show? Everyone, pretty much? Yeah? Okay. It was on for 3 years. We just ended our last season, and through my time with the show, I revealed a lot about my life in all different areas. And I know there's a lot of questions that people have had for me in regards to my sexuality, my struggle with addiction, my love life, my family, and just where I come from. I think it's a little difficult when you're on a television show to really be portrayed the way that you would like to be. You don't get an honest chance to really tell your story. I thought going into it that I would get more of an opportunity to reach out to people that might be going through some things that I've been through or that I was going through at the time. And if it did help anybody, then I'm really grateful for doing it and for being open with my life. But to give you guys a little bit of an idea of where I come from. I am in Long Beach, California. I was raised in Pasadena by my father, who is Mexican. He passed away from cancer a few years ago. Didn't get to know his side of the family very well. He was a little bit ashamed of being Mexican, and I think he felt like he would be more successful if he tried to be white. So he never would speak Spanish around me, just to my family, and wasn't really open to teaching me or letting me even in on that side of the family. My mother, who is white, is who I spent more of my time with. I wish and hope to spend more time going and researching where my family is from and a little bit more about my Latin side. Like I said, my father passed away a few years ago, so I think it's gonna just be more of a journey to explore that. I did do a jewelry line called Casa Por Vida, which was on the show, and it was just an honor of my family and my father and my way of using my own kind of talents and arts to kind of connect with him when he was gone. So I had the opportunity of doing a beautiful line called Casa Por Vida, and it was dedicated to my father. My mother and him were divorced when I was about 6, and my mother ended up marrying a woman. So I was raised with 2 moms. I didn't really have a chance to get to understand what was happening when it happened. I was pretty young, so all of a sudden, my mom's marrying a woman and we're moving in and we're about to be a family. And at that time, it was when Prop 22 was around, and it was just a totally different time period, but it was kind of, it became my family. So I was the girl that was going to school that had 2 moms, and there were no other kids in my school, at least that I knew of, that had 2 moms. One of my moms was very much dressed like a man, and the other one was much more feminine. It was very obvious to anybody that I had, you know, 2 moms when we were out in public. I didn't get teased. I didn't get harassed. I was very comfortable and honored by my family. They were an amazing family. My moms were very loving, and they raised me to be very open and accepting, and that love was love, and it just had nothing to do with the gender. My aunt was with a woman as well, so I grew up with my 2 moms and my aunt being with a woman, and that was my family. And that's what I knew, and I had my father, and it wasn't as if I was deprived of having my relationship with my father. I just had extra love. I had extra parents. So I had my 2 moms. I was raised with 2 younger brothers. My father was in the Vietnam War and sprayed with Agent Orange. That's what he passed away from. So it caused a cancer in him that he couldn't fight, and it was directly from that. And my brothers both ended up being affected by it and had special needs. So one of them is a little bit slower. He's not like retarded. The youngest one is. He's missing his 18th chromosome. And they are angels in my life. And I love them to pieces. And I'm so blessed to have them. So I've had an interesting and colorful family, to say the least, but very loving, very accepting, and used to not, I guess, being normal. I don't even know what that is, but we were a family. I was with men and growing up, and I was just going to school, doing my thing, and slowly and surely I started to find myself falling in love with women. Came out to my family when I was, I think, in my early 20s. I moved to San Francisco, and needless to say, I came back with a very fond emotions for women. So I don't think that they could really say anything, considering that I was raised with 2 moms. I didn't have to go through the struggle of coming out, which I know a lot of people go through, and to me it's just completely foreign. My family was very accepting and very loving, and it was about who I loved. And it wasn't even like a coming out for me. It was just, I love a girl right now. I have a girlfriend. This is who I love. Okay, moving on. It wasn't a big deal. It wasn't something we had to announce to the family. My whole family met my first girlfriend. It was just accepted. And then, you know, as time went on, the show started to happen. I'd been dating women. I had been dating men and just kind of exploring with my own personal journey and, you know, my young 20s, kind of who I loved and was it a man, was it a woman, and did it matter at all if it was one or the other. And the show happened in my life a few years ago. They were filming in LA with Whitney, who is one of the main characters of the show. And she was actually casted for the show, and I was not. I was just around and lived there, and it was something that kind of fell into my life. I got wrapped up in it and had been in a relationship with her before the show started, and this is when a lot of things became very public for me, and my life changed, and all of the things that come with my life were put out there for everybody to watch and have an opinion on. And probably the first time I've ever experienced any kind of bullying and discrimination, which I'd never had in my life. I was very open with my struggle on the show with my addiction to alcohol. I have struggled with bipolar since I was 14 years old, and with that came an addiction problem with alcohol. Having a camera crew on you while you're trying to get sober and figure out where in your life you are and what you can handle and what you can't handle, the stresses of it are, I can't even explain. And then to have people's opinions of what you need to be doing or how you should be living your life or what you're doing wrong is just, it's very difficult to go through. It was an incredible learning experience, and I'm grateful for it. And I got to kind of watch myself grow up in a way and go through some things that I don't think most people get to watch and actually see your actions. So I went through that with some of the show, and I went through a little bit of my journey just with my sexuality and love. And I was dating a girl named Kelsey on the show for one of the seasons. And then I started to date my ex-boyfriend on the last season of The L Word, and I actually married him. This did not go over very well with the gay and lesbian community. So to kind of give you an idea, I mean, I was raised with two moms. I had been going to gay pride since I was like 12 years old. This was my family. This is what I grew up with and just love. And then I get on the show and I'm dating a woman. It happens to be at that time in my life, I was in love with women. That's who I was falling in love with. And then at the last season, when Dusty, my husband, came back into my life, and I decided to follow my heart and leave my girlfriend and go and be with him, which thank God I did, because I'm very blessed and I love him very much. And he's been through a lot with the show and everyone's opinions. But the show pretty much told the story of a bisexual person being very confused and not to be trusted. And I guess there's the stereotypes of being greedy and not knowing what you want. And I think that we're just missing the entire point of equality and love when we start judging people within our community or anyone's story. I was following my heart. I don't consider myself bi or straight or gay or anything right now. I consider myself married, and that is really the only label that I need. And I don't think that it means it's one or the other sex. It's that I fell in love with a person, and that person happened to be a man this time. And it could have been a woman, and it could have been a man, and you don't choose these things. Your heart chooses them. And I got so much hate from the gay community that I had been a part of for so many years. And I had been throwing events and been very active, and my friends and everything I knew was a part of that community. And then I stopped being asked to show up at events, and I stopped being asked to attend any events. Anyone who was associated with me, whether it was with my clothing line or my jewelry line, anything that I had tied in and kind of worked really hard for with work was pretty much cut off. Nobody wanted to be associated with the bi girl or the girl that was with a guy. I didn't do the show so that I could be this, I am a lesbian, hear me roar. I did the show to tell my life and tell my journey and my personal story. And I think it's important to realize that even within the community, everybody's different. Everyone's story is different. And not every lesbian's the same. Not every gay person's the same. Not every straight person's the same. And the cliques and the segregation kind of, in my eyes, I just wish would stop and it would just be one big family. I mean, I guess that's like asking for peace and stuff, for everyone to love each other. But it's really sad to be fighting right now like we are for equality and for love, and then to watch people, even within the community, say such hurtful things, write such hurtful things, and really make it, I mean, even magazines like After Ellen and Auto Straddle and people I'd worked with for so many years, just ripping me apart as a person for nothing more than I left my girlfriend and fell in love with a man. And I don't think that I'm the first person who's ever fallen in love with somebody while I'm with someone. I don't think I'm the first person that's ever broken up with someone or broken somebody's heart. Whether you're gay or straight, you're going to break someone's heart and you're going to have your heart broken. It is what it is. And you follow your heart and you do your best to figure out who you're supposed to be with and where you're supposed to be. And I just happened to put myself out there and have a camera following that journey. And it opened up a lot of room for discussion and opinions, and people really wanted to give it to me. You know, I didn't deserve to be on the show. I used the show. I don't deserve to go to Gay Pride. Things that don't make any sense when we are running around marching for gay rights right now. And I think that I have every right to attend any event that's fighting for equality and show that I am there and I support it and I believe in love. And I think that even just within schools or areas where it's not as accepted, just really being aware that even within that group to be accepting, and that they are, people are different. Everybody is different. There's not a type of gay you can be or a type of straight you can be. And I think just being more aware that your friend might fall in love with an opposite sex, or your friend might fall in love with the same sex, or you might, or somebody in your family might. And it's not for anyone to judge. I do come from a kind of diverse family just to begin with my father and him being Mexican, and my brothers and my two moms, and then my journey and me being, I mean, I guess I could say bisexual, but it just doesn't matter, because I think once you're married, does it really matter what you call me? Like, I'm not going to be available anyway, so this is what it is. So that's kind of, I've had the opportunity to come here and speak to you guys, which I'm so grateful that anybody even wanted to ask me any questions, and we're considering any of the topics that I had brought up on the show and not just overlooking them, because I think they're important, and not just for my story, but for anyone who's going through it. So it's kind of how I got here. That is the show, and I'm opening up to having any questions. I'm really open, so if there's anything that you've seen or read or wanted to ask me about, I would love to answer any questions. Anyone? Silence. All right. Yes?
Like you, I also have one of my parents. My parents are divorced, and then my dad is in a same-sex partnership. I'm actually going to be married in a few weeks.
Aww.
Mm-hmm. Of, like, where I identify an individual, there's, like, kind of differences between how I see things.
Mm-hmm.
Within, like, you know, the gay community and how they see things. And I was wondering if there's, like, you guys, similar differences between you and your brother.
I think the difference, I was telling somebody earlier, it's just, like, when my parents were together, and my mother's with a man now, so she was with a woman for 10 years and is now married to a man and very happy. Obviously, you can see how fluid it is in my family. There are no boundaries at all. But I think that there's an old school thinking and mindset to some of the community, and the older generation still has so much of a kind of a, like, a wall up, or there's still boundaries that I don't think that our generation has as much, because we've seen so much happen. And I think that a lot of that old school thinking doesn't need to happen anymore. It isn't as relevant anymore. And there's a time where it's like, when you were gay, then it was very much a clique, and it was like the gay area, and this is the gay place, and this is the gay thing, and that's the straight, and that's the lesbian, and everything was just so separated. And I think that our parents, you know, like, that's more of their generation. And I think now, as like the younger ones, it's important to just kind of let all of it become one and not be so separated. And I was telling someone, I would love to see just kind of everybody in one place celebrating all kinds of people, not so separated. I think it's what hurts us the most. But I think it's different for our parents to see that, because when they were growing up and whatever they were going through, it was a lot harder. So that's it. Mm-hmm. Any other questions? Yeah.
When you were facing so much judgment and hurt, people telling you their hurtful opinions about you, what kinds of coping mechanisms did you use?
God. You know, it's hard. I have to say this just on a whole nother level, which is a good thing. Just like internet bullying, which is happening so much, whether it's a celebrity or somebody on TV or just a person that you know that you're online verbally attacking, it's gotten out of hand. I mean, we all know that. There's suicides and kids going through this every day in elementary to high school to colleges, and not even on topics of being gay, you know? Just people really finding so much like confidence behind their computers and just really being verbal and attacking. And like, I just did not expect it. I didn't know it was gonna happen. I thought I would be able to follow my heart. I wasn't gonna not fall in love with my husband because I was on The Real Outward. I mean, yes, I was filming a show. Yes, I had been in it for 3 years, but my heart was somewhere. And regardless if the cameras were there, regardless of what I was supposed to be for this show, I was falling in love with someone, and I'm gonna be with him forever. Where's the show? Show's over. So I needed to follow my heart. And by doing that, you know, I opened up that can where everybody went online. I mean, there were times that even with my brothers who were affected from Agent Orange, my father, where somebody was like, Agent Orange tastes so good. Like, they were just directly going after my family, just anything to hurt me and telling me that I was a slut or a whore and use the show, and just things that you just don't expect to have to hear on a public level. Like, it's one thing for someone to dislike you in person. It's another thing to have half of the community that's been behind you and that I was actively involved with and a part of just attacking me every single day. I mean, I couldn't open my Facebook or my Twitter or any social media. I had to stop for a minute because it was so many negative opinions. And I was telling some of the girls earlier, my husband would just look at me and he's like, just don't open it. Just don't read it. And I'd want to like argue back and like be like, you don't know me. You don't understand. This isn't fair. And I'd be like, I can't believe this person said that. And he's like, just, you can't change the minds of all these people. The best thing that I can do or anyone can do is just to be yourself and follow your heart and be true to yourself. And if it doesn't please everybody, it's not, you can't do anything about it. And you have to just know who you are and be secure. And I still show up to events today where I know people are looking and saying things and have their opinions, and I smile and I just continue on with my life. But I mean, even if it's not me and it's somebody that you do have an opinion of, getting online and attacking somebody is just so childish and so hurtful, and you don't know people's lives. You don't know their hearts and you don't know what they're going through. So I'm not for it. Obviously. Any other questions? Yeah.
Hey, Romi. Hi. I just want to say thank you again for coming off the set and speaking to everybody. You got a chance to say a little earlier today. I was wondering if you could talk a little bit about passing and what that means to you in terms of your multiracial self and also in terms of your sexuality. What kind of privilege you gain and how that might be perceived by the lesbian and gay community from moving from a relationship with a woman to a relationship with a man, and how that's kind of received. What has been your experience? Are you kind of touched on that a little bit?
Yeah. How's it been received?
Well, clearly it's not.
Yeah, not received well. I mean, I don't care. I mean, it hurts. It hurts that people are cruel to my husband. It hurts that he had to take such a beating for doing absolutely nothing. He believes in equality. He's all for gay rights. He wants to hang out and love and be a part of it. And it's just, you see a man, it's hard to get a guy like that who's so open and comfortable. And then he walks into an event and people are just glaring at him and making him feel unwelcomed. And I take that personally. And so it's like, why? He looks at me, he's like, they're really mean. I'm like, they can be. It's their opinions. They're voicing it. They're making it very clear. But there should be men and straight people and everybody, like I said, that come together. It was not received well. And I think that we say LGBTQ. We claim that we're this group, and then it ends up being lesbian or gay. And where's the in between? Where's the queer? Where's the people that are confused? Where's the people that are still figuring it out? Where do they go? What kind of love and what kind of place are we giving anybody who's not sure what they are? And it doesn't send a very good message if somebody who's publicly kind of confused and figuring out, and not confused in a bad way, it doesn't have to be a bad way, but searching for who and what person is best for them, whether be man or woman, if I can't come to my community for love and support, where do you think everybody who's watching, who watches the show and sees how it's happened to me, what girl in school is going to want to come out to her friends and say, oh, I might have fallen in love with a man, or I might have fallen in love with a woman? They obviously can see with the way that it's gone on television, it wasn't well received. And I don't think it sends a good message. I think that even the girls on the show had a responsibility, and whatever they decide to do is for them, but to show, you might not like me personally as a person, that's one thing, but to be very vocal about it being because I'm with a man is sending the wrong message. So I think that there's a lot of work still to be done.
Mm-hmm. On top of that, what do you make of the, are you cognizant of the privilege you gain by being in a relationship with a man, even though you identify within the LGBTQ community? And I was just wondering, like, what's your journey been, like, owning that privilege?
Mm-hmm.
Since, you know, you speak of your sexuality in terms of its fluidity, especially as it's been modeled within your family.
Mm-hmm.
So how do you own that privilege, and does that help you then understand maybe some of how that's triggering others?
I think people are afraid of what they don't know. I mean, we all know that. People are afraid of what they don't understand. That's why we gather our friends, because they're like us, or we make groups because they're like us. It makes us feel safe. You don't have to understand why somebody's doing what they're doing. If they're not hurting you, and they're not hurting anyone, and they're not hurting themselves, it's not for everybody to understand. And I think what I took from it was that I found that I can love a woman. I can have a relationship with a woman. I can find that person and fall in love with them. And I think for a while there, I closed myself off to the ability of loving men because I was so much a part of this lesbian group, and that just was such a bad thing to do, that you just were a lesbian, hear me roar, you know? So I just didn't even think of it. And then when it started to really kind of be inside me that I was not exploring, not being true to myself, not giving myself the opportunity to kind of go anywhere if I did have feelings for the opposite sex, you know? And I just decided to go with it, whether people understood it or not. I wasn't afraid of going there, and I wasn't ashamed of going there. I think I was really blessed to have been raised in a family that was so loving and so open, and I know that that is not the same case for most people, and that I'm very fortunate that my family just really preached, just love whoever you want to love. You can bring home anyone as long as they're a good person and they love you and you love them. And I know a lot of people don't have that same experience, but I think I just benefited from the fact that I opened my heart up, and that's not for everybody. I'm not saying that it is, but I opened my heart up to people. Before I got married, before I decided to settle down, it was, the world was mine, and I was allowed to fall in love with whoever I wanted without anyone telling me I was breaking any rules. So I feel fortunate that I've had that opportunity, and I've been able to love women, and I've been able to love my husband, but that's not everyone's story. Some women don't want to love men. Some men don't want to love women, and that's completely okay. So that's that. Any other questions? Yeah.
So as far as race goes, right,
mm-hmm.
that your father wasn't really proud of his Mexican heritage.
No.
And you were raised by your German mother.
Mm-hmm.
So did you kind of like grow up considering yourself white? Or?
I did. There was a part of me, my father, he was, you know, my mom ended up marrying my stepmother, who was very wealthy and very much in the white Pasadena kind of area. And my father was from downtown and from more poverty and Mexican family. And so I had these two very extreme homes. He didn't feel very welcomed. Once we kind of moved to Pasadena and had this lifestyle, he felt ashamed, I think, that he was Mexican. He was always trying to be the one in his family to start a business. He didn't have an education. Always coming up with ideas, always trying to start something for himself. And any money he made, he sent it to his family, you know, and help them out. But it was almost like he felt like he wasn't going to be accepted. And it's an old school way of thinking for a Mexican man at the time, but it was like he wasn't going to be accepted for the job, or he wasn't going to, like, he would ask my mom when they were together to show up with him for, like, job interviews, because she was, like, a blonde woman, and he thought it might help him get the job, or they'd respect him a little bit more, or, you know, if they saw her on his arms. And he would speak Spanish to my family, and he would not teach me. He did not want me to grow up like that. It's kind of sad, because I would have loved to have known that part of me. I would have loved to have spent time with my family. I would have loved to have been able to speak Spanish and have that entire, you know, amazing culture be a part of me. And he kind of, in a sense, deprived me of it, but it was for his own personal reasons, which is so sad to feel like you have to be ashamed of. And it's what, unfortunately, did not let my dad succeed in life. I mean, he was passed away from cancer, you know, about 5 years ago, and I watched him work until the day he died, like just struggling till the day he died. He wasn't able to kind of take any time and rest. He didn't have that backing. And it was because he kind of held himself back by not being him, by constantly trying to be something that he wasn't, or being ashamed of who he was. And it kind of broke my heart to see that happen with somebody, to feel like just because of your race, you weren't going to succeed as well. You know, and it holds you back. You have to just own who you are. So.
I'm not sure what the demographics are in, like,
white. I have sometimes the family with the two special needs, the Mexican daughter and the two moms, in a very white neighborhood.
So, like, was there a point in time where, like, you realized that you were, like Latina, or, like, half Latina?
Yeah, there was a time when I, like, actually got it, because I grew up with my mom and all my cousins, and very, very family-oriented, white family. And then as I got older, I was like, there is a part of me that's, like, missing here that I haven't really explored. I am Mexican. My last name is Garcia. Okay, my father, it's not, I'm Mexican. So I think that there was a part that was like, man, this has really been pushed aside. I need to figure out who that person is and what that part is. And I was speaking to you earlier, and you were telling me how you went and, you know, got to visit some of your dad's family and get to know kind of where you come from. And I think it's important. I think it's definitely a next step in my life to really go spend some time with them and get to know that part of me. And I think it would be important to him, because my father loved his family and his culture. He just was ashamed of it. And then when you grow up in a white neighborhood like I did, in a very, it's just, you don't even want to talk about it. So I think the more you get secure with who you are, and as I got older, and as I had so many people judging me all the time, I think I just finally got to a place in my life where I was like, I just don't care what your opinion is anymore. And this is my life, and this is my journey, and I'm allowed to explore and use my time on earth to figure out whatever it is I need to do. So, anybody else? Yeah.
Okay, how real was the show?
Mm-hmm.
Portrays sexual
minority relationships. Oh boy. You don't want to hear my opinion. the show. The first season of The Real L Word, and I think the first season of any reality show, if you're not a celebrity, like already a celebrity that goes into having a reality show where it's just media and they're just kind of funding your career by following your life, our show was a bunch of girls in LA. That were lesbians, that were just really active in the scene in LA, because that's what the original L Word was, and that's what they were kind of trying to follow. So they did a casting call, and they casted who they thought would be the best personalities for the show. I was running lesbian parties at the time, and obviously was a drunken mess that time in my life. So that was my scene. Whitney had auditioned for the show. Sorry, and then she was casted for the show. We met right before filming. I remember her telling me, there's a camera crew coming into my life in about a month. I'm on some show. And I was just like, oh, okay, whatever. And then when the camera really showed up, it was like, oh, this is real. There is a camera crew. You are really on. Didn't know what was going on. I wasn't. And I was so in love with her at that moment in my bliss of drunken lesbian love that I thought, it doesn't matter that there's a camera. It does matter. And I learned very quickly and the hard way. I kind of ran from the cameras for the first month and didn't want to be on. And just kept running and crying and trying, this is my love and you can't follow it. And finally one day at my work, my boss, it was so funny because I had been running from the cameras for a few weeks when we started filming and refusing to sign my paperwork. And I just started a job as a makeup artist at Planet Salon. And my boss comes to me one morning and says, we're filming a show today. It's called The L Word and you're doing one of the girls' makeups. And I was like, and she's like, so you need to sign. And I was like, well, this is my new job. I'm not going to say no. It's on the show doing another character's makeup of the show that I've been running from. Sure enough, I signed that paperwork and it all happened. So I gave in and decided to go with it and stop running from it. They ended up filming at so many of the clubs I was at or bars I was at and people that were in my life that you couldn't really avoid it at that time. You were going to run into them. So to answer your story, the first year was a little bit more organic and very much like raw emotion happening and people just figuring it out. The second year, after a horrible incident on the first season, being drunk and with the sexual stuff that went on Showtime, I realized that I had a drinking problem. I was blacking out at the time and I didn't think that it was the best time to have a camera follow my life. I didn't want that to be who I was. So I told them that I was going to get sober and that they were allowed to follow that, but they weren't going to get the drunk girl. It just wasn't going to happen. So they agreed that that was fine because ultimately they want drama. They want you to be drunk. They want you to be crazy. So the second season was a little bit more organic. And then by the third season, I could have won an Emmy. I mean, it was just, it was... You've been on the show for 3 years, you know what to do. We're gonna need you to do this, we're gonna need you to do that. I know this happened months ago, but we didn't catch it, so we're gonna need you to do it today. So as I'm in a relationship with my girlfriend, I'm reliving a relationship with an ex at the same time, and one of them's fake and one of them's real. And then it's edited, and people have to realize that when you watch a show, you don't know that person. It is a television show. You get parts of my story, you get to understand bits of who I am or whoever it is you're watching, you don't know them. So to assume that you do or make judgment like you do, please take it as a television show for entertainment. Get what you get out of it. I think it's amazing that Showtime put lesbians out there and put love out there and put our storylines out there because there were some really good stories to be told that get lost in the drama of everything. And I think that if people were just more aware, especially people not from LA, that these shows are TV shows. So our show ended the third season this last year. I think that they're gonna continue and be going into like smaller areas and filming real stories. And I think it's gonna go back to being a little bit more organic and what it was supposed to be when it first started, which I respect and I think it needs to. I think there's a lot of stories out there that need to be told. And I think creating characters to try and emulate the original L Word is just tacky. So I'm happy it's over. And I'm grateful for the experience. And I learned a lot. But definitely got my acting chops in there. Yeah.
And what do you think about the media, like television in general, how they portray sexual minority relationships?
I think that in general, people love to, when it comes to gay or lesbian or anything, what is it, sex? And there's a relationship there. There's love. There's a relationship like everybody else, and everyone's mind automatically goes to sex, the bedroom. If it is a same-sex couple, that's what they're going to focus on. And that is sad because there's so much more to a relationship emotionally, especially in a same-sex relationship, that can be told other than just wanting to know what goes on in the bedroom. And I think it's sad that they exposed so much of us and that they continue to do that on television. And I mean, we all know sex sells, but hopefully they get it right. And hopefully, I mean, you get it more out of documentaries and movies, I think, when you're really telling a real story. But I think that the media, as we all know, is not out for your best interest at all. So, yeah, you just pick yourself up. Any other questions? We've been so quiet. Yeah. Yeah.
If you could go back in time, what advice would you give yourself, and what would you?
Good Lord. So much advice. It's a good question. Everyone asks me if I regret what I did on the show and if I regret my decisions, which is an obvious. I'm not saying this to be cheesy, but I don't regret my life. I was growing up. I'm still growing up. I'm still going to make really bad decisions. I think that the only thing that I wish I would have known more going in was the story that you're trying to tell will not be told through a reality show. Don't allow people to expose you that way. I gave in a little bit too much with who I was just to get people off my back to make a TV show, and it ended up hurting me rather than helping me. And I regret going along with things that weren't true so that a real story could have been told, or holding back what the producers wanted because I was trying to help them, and it just didn't help anybody by doing it. So I regret more production parts of it, but going through what I went through on camera, I have been places where it's helped people. Our girls have come up to me and said, you know, I have this problem, or I'm bisexual, or I'm bipolar, and I deal with this, or my brothers, or my family, or my dad. And being able to meet people all over the world and talk to them and help each other and be there for them was like such an incredible experience that I'm happy I was honest about it, because those are the people you do it for. The ones that want to hate and get online, I could care less about, so. Yeah. Any other questions? Yeah.
So I was recently watching a video on Huffington Post talking about how the media is kind of creating this narrative of what it means to be LGBTQ, and especially the particular video was talking about trans identity.
Mm-hmm.
But I was wondering, from your experience, kind of jumping off of the question from run up here in terms of the show,
mm-hmm.
how much of the creative, the production, and the people that were behind the scenes were actually LGBTQ, and were they concerned with what that
was? Yeah.
In the broader image?
It's a good question. The camera crew and the people that were filming the stories, every person on the show had their own crew to follow their story and tell their story, and they were smart by putting lesbian crews together for each person so that we felt comfortable, so that the people that were filming us, the people that were with us, were other lesbians. And they're smart. What's going to make you most comfortable when you're spending every day with women? When it comes to revealing things about yourself, you just become, you forget. And that's very genius on their part, because you're not uncomfortable. You're not weirded out by the fact that they're there with you every single day. The men within the company who do the editing, who do the actual story, are straight men. So yes, you gave me a lesbian crew to film and get me comfortable, but the person who ends up editing it is not a lesbian. So the stories come out, I don't know, I don't feel, and maybe this is just my opinion, obviously, but I don't feel like the show really represented what the community was. And I don't think it really fought for any kind of rights or love. I think that it told some stories that are common, like coming out to your parents, being African American in the community with Saj and Franny coming out, and Whitney being the player who, you know, finds love everywhere, and me being the crazy girl that's obsessed and confused. Like, I think they created characters, but I don't think they really were telling the story of bisexuality, transgender, queer community, and that still needs to be told. And I think people still want to see it. I think what you got was an edited, dramatic version of a bunch of drunk lesbians. I do. For your entertainment, so.
Actually, when we met earlier today, I made mm-hmm. a comment that I felt that for the first time when I watched the show, I was seeing a non-fetishized version of intimacy between women.
Mm-hmm.
So it's interesting that now you're sharing. Actually was, you muddled or diluted.
Well, you saw intimacy, I think, in the sense that you saw two women having sex, but I don't necessarily know that they showed intimacy. So I think that people were surprised to see, and I think it was great that they show men and women having sex on television all the time and with all the HBO shows and stuff, and it's very open. And I don't think you can say we can't show women or men. You can. You should. People should see that it's real, that we do make love, that it can happen between the same sex. And I think it opens people's eyes that it's not some crazy, what are they doing behind, you know, behind the door. And I think that was awesome that I was in a show that was able to do that. But I think that there's a level of intimacy that still wasn't told. I think it was too much concerned about, oh, this is two women having sex. So, any other questions? Yes? Yeah?
One of the things I like about your show, just the characters that are about what it said, it showcases some of the talents of the people on the show.
Mm-hmm.
You have your website, kendarumi.com.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm.
You know, when you get an opportunity to be on television like I did and to have everyone tuning in, you obviously, whether people want to say, oh, you're money hungry or fame hungry, whatever it is, no one's stupid. If you have an opportunity and you're artistic to put your work out there, I would hope anybody would. You know, I'm very creative. I've always been my entire life. I've done acting and singing and dancing since I was a kid and always making things and just constantly coming up with something new. So when I had the chance to, I've worked in fashion and beauty and music my whole life, I was like, well, I'm gonna follow this. I'm gonna do this. And when I was getting sober, being creative and creating businesses and working was like the best thing I could have done for myself. It kept my mind very focused and it kept me busy in an area of my life that I needed to be busy and not so much with the party. It saved me, honestly, for quite a few years and turned my life around, just focusing on my work and my art and who I am. I put it out there, I do my blog, which is Tender Romi. I did a radio show this last year, which we just took a little break from, we'll be coming back next year, with Rose Garcia, who is on the show. And it gave us a chance to be us, produce it, write it, let people in on who we are, and not who the show made us to be. And it just was an hour show of kind of recapping what's going on in pop culture and having fun with all of it. A lot of the stuff that I was doing kind of hit a wall because my audience and the people that were following me were lesbians. So when they decided that they weren't the biggest fans of me, well, there goes some of your work. So I continue to work on what I love to do. Either you accept it, you don't accept it, you love it, or you don't love it, but I'm a creative person, and anyone who's creative is going to continue to do it regardless if people are receiving it or not, so.
I'm also curious if you've maintained any relationships
with the show. Yeah, I've made so many amazing friends from the show. Corey and Casey are family to me. Rose Garcia, who's from the first season, is one of my best friends and pretty much my family at this point. I'm so grateful that I got these beautiful women in my life. There are a few that I don't speak to, and just because we were on a show together doesn't mean that we get along or that we want to be friends. And I think we're all adults and can decide what people you want in your life. So when the show ended, you just go your own ways and you keep the ones that you have something in common with and that you have the same beliefs as, and the ones that you don't, you wish them the best and continue on.
So what's the greatest thing you took away from your 3 seasons of working with this reality show?
I got to travel. I got to see Europe. I got to see all these crazy little towns I never would have been to. I got to meet so many people. And I wanted to travel my whole life. And to have it the way that it was, where I was just going everywhere and being able to fly there and have people welcome me into their homes and show me around and get like a first-hand tour of places, and it really opens your mind. I mean, I highly recommend traveling to anybody who can, and it's difficult and expensive, but it just makes you realize that there is a big world out there, and your little problem at home is so small, so small. So I'm really grateful for that. Yeah. Yeah? Hi.
You mentioned the character named Sash that was on the show.
I love her. Yeah, good. This is a good topic.
Character of the show.
Yeah.
And just from watching the show, it just seems like it was two different worlds that it was portrayed. Like it was a white lesbian community and then there was just one little African
American. Yeah. Yeah, the sad thing with that too is Sasha is one of the most intelligent people that we have ever had on our show. She's incredible.
And in particular, I just remember like one episode there was like a march that was happening, and it was just kind of like Sasha and that community, and it wasn't kind of like the community of all the cast. So I wanted to get your opinion. One, if you feel like that the show accurately portrayed like the distance.
Yeah. Yeah, I think it was sad the way they did it because obviously we all know, I mean, the stereotypical, like when they try and like just put an African-American in and now we're very cultured and we have everybody. There's an Asian, there's a black person, there's a Mexican. We love everyone. But it didn't show like that. Obviously, you guys didn't receive it that way and I don't think that she did as well. Saj is so politically involved, very much more than anybody on that show involved, and she works for the Gay and Lesbian Center. She is constantly preaching love. She's the most accepting human being I've ever met. And when she came on the second season, I think it was, well, we're going to need a black person. Here's Saj. But then they didn't really follow her story right. And they didn't bring her in with the rest of us. It was very separated. And I remember meeting Saj for the first time. It was my birthday party. We were filming. It never aired because most of the stuff doesn't air. But they were like, oh, this is Saj. She's your new cast member. You guys are friends. It's my birthday. I'm looking at her like, okay. Like now we're friends because we're on a show. Thank God I ended up falling in love with her and knowing that she's this beautiful person. They should have kept her on. I think they pushed her to the back a lot. I think that it was more for their own, we have a black person on the show, than really telling even what her struggle was. Or did she feel accepted? Or was it easy for her even within our show? Did she feel kind of, you know, put aside and not in one. I mean, in the photo shoots too, like sometimes they would push the heavier ones to the back or they'd push, you know, her to the back or hide them. And it was really hard to see. You could tell that everyone was being placed where they needed to be placed, but nobody was really being considered. So I think she should have come back. I think there should have been more than just one. I think it should have gone into her community and everyone's community. And like I said, I think that they focused on the wrong areas. And mind you, it's only an hour show, so they had to chop it up. But Saj's life didn't necessarily fit in with everybody. She had more going on than anybody did on the show. And they would rather focus on Whitney falling in love with girls than Saj preaching with her girlfriend down in the middle of downtown LA. So, yeah, I don't think they portrayed it very well. Yeah. I wish they didn't. I wish labels didn't matter. I know that people need them, and I know that it's important, like even with a group like this, to have a safe place for people to go. And by putting a name on it, it gives you a safe place to be. We all want to identify with others. I don't think that there's enough confidence sometimes and strength within people to just be them. So when you're secured and have people around you that are like you, it gives you the strength. I'm not putting down any of the labels, but I think that they hurt us sometimes. And I know that me saying, hey, I'm a lesbian, like I did, because that's what I thought I was, because I was in love with women, and my friends were gay, and this was my community, that when I decided, oh my God, I love this man, I'm gonna go for that, by me saying I was a lesbian, I actually hurt myself. Like, if you're just you, and you love a woman, or you love a man, or you love both, or, you know, you wanna be a man, or you wanna be, whatever it is, like, just be you. And I think when we get to a point where it's like that and there isn't a label, there's not going to be the cliques and the segregation and the judgment. It's just people. So I don't like it. I'm uncomfortable saying bisexual, but it is what the label I kind of can identify with. So, yeah.
Have there been friendships that were kind of broken because you and your husband got together.
Oh, yeah.
And then now you guys are fine and have pushed past that, or has there always been standstill still with these people, or?
No, I lost a lot of friends first when I got sober. A lot. Because you figure out who are your friends and who are your party friends. And I watched, I mean, they dropped. I was like, okay, I got like five of you left. Let's go. And then when I had them, and then I was with a guy, nobody wanted to be associated with me while the show was being filmed. Because then Whitney didn't like me, and she's the main person. A lot of people were very vocal on the last season. They didn't like that I was with men. And I think people didn't want to say anything. So if they were friends with me and they were, you know, agreeing with what I was doing, then they weren't going to look as cool. And they hurt me. And these are people I've been friends with for years, before there was a show, during the show, and they went. They, in a sense, it's so sad to say, like, chose a side. But people do that. And then when the show is over, and, you know, lately I've had a lot of those people come back into my life, and I forgive. You should always forgive. I love them. They're allowed to be in my life. And it's like, what do they say? Like, you can forgive, just don't forget. Like, I forgive you. I love you. I'm not going to forget that when I was standing alone and needed my support and my friends, a lot of you guys didn't want to be associated with me. So some of them were strong. Rose Garcia from the show has always had my back, whether everyone was looking at me. You know, because she's my friend. You're friends with somebody because you love them, not because of who they love.
Were you friends with her prior to the show?
Me and Rose are from LA. We didn't become very close until the show, but I ended up having the tightest relationship with her out of anybody, which is completely ironic because we are complete opposites. She's a wild animal and the most lesbian person I've ever met in my life. So, but we managed to be the best of friends. Yeah.
So, in looking at your commentary on whether or not labels matter, and then this idea that you've sort of touched on whether or not one is gay enough or lesbian enough, and those really being the dominant, like, narratives in the LGBTQ plus community, How do you feel that marginalization of folks, that whether or not they don't fit into the L and the G, and, like, especially our community members that are non-monosexual, like, limits our ability to, like, move forward as a community?
Oh, completely. It's limiting us. I just think that right now, it doesn't look good when you're asking everybody to look at you as a community that's here about love. We're preaching love, that this is love. This isn't about who I'm having sex with. I love this person. I can't control it. I love this person. Accept that, acknowledge that, and give me the right to do that. And people are looking at you and they're trying to decide if they accept this or not. But then we're in the community placing people and putting labels and causing hatred and dividing it. You can't grow and ask for something when you still don't have it together yourself. And I think that there's a lot of judgment, a lot of labels, a lot of prejudice within it, with how gay you are, how straight you are, who can go where, who can go there. And people should be separated by personalities or interests. You know, I like science, that's why we're gonna go to the science place, or I like art, that's why I'm gonna go to the art place. But not, I'm this gay, you're this gay, you're not gay enough, you're too gay, you're too straight. I mean, I said that, I went to Gay Pride last year to support gay rights and love and equality, and I was asked why I was there. And that just made me think, you're holding everyone back by still having that state of mind. Like, you're not representing very well. Not that anyone needs to represent, but it just takes us back. It shouldn't matter. So I don't like the labels. And I learned that the hard way, because I was the first to put labels on myself. So I had to learn to remove them personally. So, yeah.
I have a question from
Twitter. Okay. Good Lord.
What's next for Romi Kids after the baby?
I got a guinea pig. I don't know if you follow me on social media, but I got an amazing guinea pig. No kids right now. I'm still growing up. My husband's still growing up. We just got married. We're into our second year, and we have us to work on right now. And right now, it's hard to have kids. Good Lord, that's a whole new challenge. So I think I'm just going to master trying to have a good, healthy relationship right now. And work, I just keep on struggling and hustling, and it's all I can do, and be grateful I have a job every day. Anything else? Yeah.
I have an anonymous question.
Okay.
How do you convince people it's okay to love regardless of gender?
I don't convince people. I think just by, it's so tacky, whatever, but like your actions speak louder than your words. So people that did have something against me or were very vocal have sometimes come back to me and said, just seeing your love with your husband and that it didn't end the day the show ended, and that it continued and that you guys are happy, just showing people your happiness is the best way to show that that's love. This is what it is. This is who I am. And like I said, I'm not here to prove anything. I'm just here to be me, and everybody needs to just be them. That's all. I'm not trying to like do anything other than that. So, is that it? Yeah?
You said you've traveled quite a bit. Where do you live now currently? Do you still live in Pasadena?
No, I live in Long Beach, so I work in L.A.
Is that where you want to be?
No. I hate L.A. I'd live on your campus if I could. It's beautiful here. My husband's from Pittsburgh, and so he's East Coast, and so he really loves the beach right now, and he doesn't want to leave it. I beg him every day. But I work in LA, I do work in fashion, I do celebrity styling for Moods in Norway. I dress all different celebrities for events and stuff in suits. And I drive there from Long Beach because I don't want to live in West Hollywood ever, ever again. So I drive to my little beach community, which Long Beach is an incredibly gay community too. If you've ever been to Long Beach, it's got a huge community. It's a cool, cool town. And then I drive to work and I drive back. My family lives in Long Beach. My mother is my best friend. So yeah, I would love to be kind of in the middle of nowhere. I could live on a farm with a ton of guinea pigs. So it's not going over real well at home right now, so. Any other questions? Yeah?
So living in LA and working in LA, I work there as well.
Mm-hmm. Oh, yeah.
How do you, learning what you've learned through your past, kind of distance yourself from that and not get caught up in what the world says you should have?
I am blessed to have been raised around the industry. My stepmother was a music producer. I've been around kind of Hollywood or whatever since I was a child. And then I've worked in fashion and beauty. And I've always, just because it's where I'm from, so I'm not too jaded in that whole thing. And then being on the show and getting to taste like tiniest amount of celebrity because of that, when it was all over, and I work just like everyone else, I have a normal job, I'm not Kim Kardashian, I'm not rich, there's none of that. I think that you realize that so much of it's just stars and dust, and everyone is just going to work, and even the celebrities that come in, they're going to work on their set, they're jobs. So you start to just look at everybody like, this is your job, it's an awesome job, you're doing what you love, but you're no better than me, you're no different than me. And by removing myself from it and going home to a kind of away from it, I don't get lost in it. I'm not struggling to be famous, I'm just trying to work. So I think it's easy to move there and get lost in it and be real hungry. If you're not from LA and you just get in there and you get a taste of it, you tend to get that little like, I gotta have more. It's not healthy. So I just try and separate myself from it. Yeah.
A comment that I get a lot is like, oh, you don't look gay.
Oh God, yeah.
So how do you think along with like fashion? Like, how do you think like fashion and style like goes into like your gender expression?
I think it'd be anything. I mean, when we did the show, people were like, lesbians don't look like that. I was like, well, they do. They do in LA. They don't look like that everywhere, but in fact, they do look like that in LA. Every area is different, but there were lesbians that were upset that they were too girly, or they, you know, what does a lesbian look like? Is there supposed to be a look that a lesbian looks like? I thought it was about loving somebody. I didn't know that we had to all have my hair cut and wear Converse like I do. And I'm here, I am married to a guy, and I still dress casually butch at times, you know? It doesn't matter. It doesn't matter what you dress like. It doesn't change who you love. And some people are very masculine, some very, very feminine, and you shouldn't be able to tell what someone's preference is just by seeing them walk down the street. You shouldn't have to know. So, you don't look like a lesbian. I'm just kidding. I'm just kidding. Any other questions? Is that it? Are you just standing? Yeah. Okay. All right. I don't know. Yeah. Thank you, guys. Thank you for having me.
And now we're going to have the president of QPOC.
Thank you, Romi, for flying all the way
pissed
night to Blacksburg.
Thank you.
LA. And also thank you to our host, Takara Watson, for flying from Syracuse, New York. So on behalf of the Women's Center, Multicultural Programs and Services, the Office for Diversity and Inclusion, QPOC and BT, a lot of people put this together, and I wanted to give a shout out, especially to Mr. Brian Gregg, who's over there. He answered every one of my annoying emails and handled was great. Walking into his office at random times to ask questions. So I appreciate you letting me happen. Also, I'd like to thank the LGBTA for advertising, tweeting, making sure people were here. I'm glad to see everyone came out.
Yeah, yourself? Thank you.
No, but on behalf of QPOC, we have a small token of our appreciation.
What?
For you. It's not an Emmy. Woo! Something, so thank you for coming.
Thank you, hon. Thank you. Woo! My first Emmy.
So now we have some time.
So cute.
So if you're interested in.
Oh my god, it's so cute. It's my first award ever.
You're welcome.
Thank you.
If you're interested in taking pictures, questions 101, she'll be over here. Try not to run this way.
Or just come over at all, please.
Well, we have security. But she'll be here until 8 o'clock. Thank you again for coming.
Thank you, guys.